Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Know-How is brought to you by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This episode of Know-How is brought to you by Lynda.com, the online learning platform with over 3,000 on-demand video courses to help you strengthen your business, technology, and creative skills. For a free 10-day trial, visit Lynda.com/know-how. That's LYNDA.com/know-how. Tonight, Brian plays with an Xbox.
Padre gets gassy.
And go FPV yourself. It's the Twitch show where we build, bend, break, and upgrade. I'm Father Robert Ballasaire.
And I'm Brian Burnett.
And for the next minutes, we're going to be showing you some of the projects that we've been playing with so you can go home and create on your own.
Right. And if you haven't guessed it out yet, we're giant nerds.
We are big.
As we Kamehameha the camera.
Now, in post, can you put the actual energy ball?
Easily. But, you know, you do have to get your power level over 9,000.
I know, it's got
to
be.
Otherwise, we're going to have to work on that.
Yeah. Now, we've got a great episode for you. We're going to be showing you how to fix the red ring of death. For all you Xbox 360 owners out there, this is that dreaded blink, blink, blink that tells you that, you got to go buy an Xbox.
That every Xbox of this design suffers. Aww. So if you have one that looks like this, it will die at
eventually,
one point or another.
Yes. It's not a question of if, it's a question of when.
Mine hasn't yet.
Well, that's because you don't play it enough.
Yeah. If you bring it down to the no-hole where it's played 24-7, it will break.
And you have an Xbox One now, so
We're also going to take you back to Maker Faire. We're going to show you about gasification. This is actually a project that I've been wanting to do in know-how for a while, but I've held back because I was worried about killing everyone in the studio.
That seems to be more of a concern for your projects than it should be.
I know, right?
More often than not.
It's really bad. I don't know. Like, half the projects I get the little, we would prefer that you not do this.
Right. Next to your projects, it says dangers. And it's like, could kill everyone.
Most dangers are like, could mar the surface of the table, might possibly cause an electrical short. Uh-huh. We'll kill everyone in Brick House.
Right. We got to be careful with those ones.
And we're also going to be showing you FPV. You guys have asked for it. We're going to actually show you how to assemble an inexpensive rig. You've been looking at $500, $600, maybe $800 for a decent rig. Well, if you just want to get started, don't do that, because we've got one that goes for under $100.
And so, should we talk about our first story?
Let's do that.
The most powerful engine in the world.
It's a V8, right? A Hemi?
I think so, yeah.
No, it's totally not at
it's
all.
It's going to be a Ford engine, I'm pretty sure.
Now, we've got a video here that will show you this engine. This is the Rocketdyne, the Aerojet RS-25. For you space geeks, you space nerds, if this sounds familiar, it's because it is familiar. This is the space shuttle engine. Now, this is a liquid-fueled cryogenic engine that was conceived in the 60s, designed in the 70s, and operated since the 80s. Now, we may think that technology from the 80s is old, we shouldn't use it anymore, but it is amazing. It is an amazing piece of technology. And here, you're going to actually see them assemble one of these things.
I mean, if you get it right, you know, like the Game Boy, then it's going to be good tech.
It is good tech. And more importantly, especially in the field of rocketry, it's proven tech. They've never had a major incident with one of these engines, and they've really tested it. I mean,
I was going to say that's probably the main thing you're looking for when it comes to building a rocket engine.
Blowing up is bad. Now, remember in these rocket engines, these are going to go into space, so you need to have both the fuel and the oxidizer on board.
Right.
Which is that big tank that you used to see attached to the space shuttle. That was liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen that you would mix through a turbo pump.
Pretty safe stuff.
Super safe. When we were developing our first rocket engines in this country, we couldn't make proper two-stage engines. They kept blowing up.
That could be a downside.
Yeah, and what a two-stage engine does is, okay, so here's how the process works. You ignite some of the fuel to turn a pump. That pump, in turn, pressurizes the fuel so that it can go into the main engine at full pressure, right? The problem was you wasted a lot of power in that first stage, that pump.
In that conversion kind
of
area.
Yeah, yeah. Now, what you want, ideally, is you want the exhaust, the thrust from that going into the main engine so you're not wasting any of that energy.
Right.
The Germans figured out how to do this a long time ago, but when we did it,
ooh.
Yeah, we blew up a lot of stuff trying to perfect a two-stage engine. Well, this RS-25 is a proper two-stage engine. It burns with 418,000 pounds of thrust at liftoff.
So
there's three of these, remember. Three of these on the shuttle.
So I'll have my steak well done.
Super well done. Oh, the SRBs, those solid rocket boosters on the side of the shuttle, they were actually more powerful. They generated a total of 2,800,000 pounds of lift, which was 83% of the total thrust at liftoff. But remember this. They only burned for about 2 minutes, and then they separated.
Right.
Whereas the orbital burn took 8-some minutes. So most of the thrust, most of the power is actually going to be coming off those 25s.
Jeez. Yeah, I mean, the whole process is just containing a constant explosion.
Explosion.
Right. Yeah.
And the way that they did it, because one of the weakest parts of any rocket engine is going to be the nozzle. You need the nozzle, because the nozzle is actually what's going to
funnel
that thrust. Otherwise, again, you just have an explosion going everywhere.
That's the hard part.
That's the hard part. The problem is our materials tend to,
melt
at 3,000-plus degrees Celsius.
So what do you do to get around that?
So what you do, and this is what was brilliant in that engine design, they have loops. And you could see this if you go to the old pictures. There were loops that went around the nozzles. That wasn't just decoration. Uh-huh. That was actually channels for the fuel to flow. The hydrogen would actually flow around that. So it would go from liquid hydrogen, get heated up by that flame. It would cool off the nozzle so that it wouldn't melt. But then you'd also get super pressurized fuel dumped back into the system.
What? Okay, so
right?
that's brilliant.
That's
because
brilliant
the liquid
design.
Hydrogen has to be really cold, right? To be
super
maintained
cold.
That it is as a liquid. Yeah.
Yep. Yep.
Oh
yep.
Wow.
Now,
that is a cool process.
It's,
yeah.
it's a very cool process.
Literally.
When you think of everything that you have to do, from the engine belt to the nozzle to that coolant so the thing doesn't melt before you get to the orbit. And when you think of the fact that I think they only, they built 46 of these engines. So all of those shuttle flights were off those 46 engines that they built. They could just refurbish them and put them back into service.
Oh, wow.
It's amazing piece of tech. And it's so amazing that we're still using it today. This is tech from 50 years ago. And it's going to be the main engine on the next space vehicle that the United States is making. It's the same one, the exact same one. And again, proven tech, why not use it?
Yeah, you got it right. It has a success, a proven success rate. So yeah, stick with it.
It's going to be part of the space launch system.
That's cool.
Yeah,
I had no idea about the funneling of the hydrogen to the nozzle like that.
And actually, there's, I can't remember, oh gosh, this is a Top Gear thing. There is a supercar that actually uses fuel to cool a certain component.
So kind of the same idea, yeah.
Yeah, same idea. I mean, obviously not to the same extent. You mm-hmm. don't have an engine up to 3,000 degrees Celsius.
No.
I mean, you good if it
if
was
you,
on fire.
Right. There are some vehicles that have had that happen. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. So there you have it, folks. A little bit of space geekery. I know there's a lot of space geek in me, and I'm hoping there's a little bit in you. Check out the next generation, the Space Launch System, because it's a technical bonanza.
And then just check out the next generation Star Trek, right?
Yes, because they use the S-25.
Is that how they go warp speed? Yeah,
yeah,
I think that's how it works, right?
No. Now, we will be going back to Maker Faire in just a bit. But first, we wanted to show you how to fix your Xbox. Now, Brian, tell me a little bit about what's going on with this thing.
So this is the original Xbox 360, prone to the red ring of death. And that is caused by poor cooling and really poor solder joints.
This was the thing that fascinated me, because it's not like anything failed. The components didn't fail. It's just it got hot enough to kind of flow the solder just enough so you would have components that would lift.
Yeah.
And I remember there were videos when this first started happening of people putting their Xboxes into ovens.
Yes. Actually, I was one of those people. I wrapped my Xbox in a towel, let it run for about 10 hours, get super hot, and then put it in the freezer. And it worked for about another hour after that, and then it was done.
And then totally done.
So, ever since iFixit has been a sponsor of ours, I've always wanted to do this project But, you know, I haven't been playing. I got an Xbox 360 Slim a while back, and now I have an Xbox One. A friend came to me. He really wanted me to fix this. He even has this intercooler fan. It didn't save it.
It really did.
It didn't do anything.
No.
So took it apart, followed the iFixit kit stuff, like got all the things from them, and made it work again.
Well, what do you say we take a look at it?
Yeah, sure. Hit the button, director.
So if you happen to own a Xbox 360, one of the original guys like this, chances are it is going to die. Part of that is poor ventilation, and there is a kit that you can get from iFixit to either prevent this from happening or fix it. If you're going to be fixing a Red Ring of Death like I am, you're definitely going to need a heat gun or something similar. Now, this is a friend of mine's Xbox 360. He had a cooler fan on it, and it had a spider nest in there, kind of scary, but it may have given this Xbox a little extra life, but definitely didn't save it. So the first thing to do is going to be taking off the grills off the top and the bottom of the Xbox, and also the front faceplate. They can be a little tricky, especially now that these Xboxes are getting a little old, the plastic's getting a little brittle. Remove the front Microsoft sticker. Don't worry, the warranty is definitely done. In the kit, iFixit kit also comes with this little popper tool that'll help pop the tabs, which are super irritating on the back of the Xbox 360. And once you get those pulled off, you can kind of pry it away gently from the rest of the case. Now, you have a bunch of little screws that you can take out here. If you get the iFixit kit, they're hex screws, so that the tool comes with that to take those out. There's long screws that we're going to take out first because those attach to the other side of the case. And once we've done that, we can flip it over, remove the case, and then we can start working on taking off the, we can take off the disk drive, remove the disk drive, remove the fan, remove the front button area. And if you're looking for like detailed pictures and things like that, iFixit has a great write-up. I'll have a link to that in the show notes. Remove the smaller screws from the center because we're going to be pulling the board out here in a sec. All right, now we're able to get, I was able to get the bottom part of the case off. There's these X holsters for the heat sinks, and what you do is you kind of wiggle your way with a flathead screwdriver at the edges to kind of pop them off. Once you're done removing the X holsters here, you can take off these little thermal pads that are on the bottom of the RAM chips. Some Xboxes don't have those, but so if they're not there, don't worry about it. Next is removing the old thermal paste from the CPU and GPU. It's pretty gunky stuff, so fortunately iFixit provides some thermal paste remover, and you can just scrape away with, use a plastic scraper, definitely not a metal scraper, to get some of this off, and then put some of the thermal paste remover on top of that to kind of gently break it away, and use like a paper towel to kind of wipe away all the excess old thermal paste. You really want to make sure to get these guys clean. Once you've got the CPU and GPU spotless, make sure to do the same thing to the heat sinks and get all that excess gunk off of there. Next, we're going to heat up the board. So this is the area that you want to make sure to heat up. Try not to get the heat too close to these capacitors, these little cylinders over here and stuff. You want to be careful not to heat those up too much. But we're going to want to warm up the back of the board to kind of get things started and just nice and evenly distribute the heat, and do that for about a minute till the board gets a little warm. And then next you're going to want to go in a kind of clockwise pattern, in never leave the heat gun in one spot for too long, but for 4 minutes just go around in circles, making sure that each chip in this sequence gets a little bit of attention with the heat gun until things warm up. Because what we're doing here is heating up the soldering, getting it to reflow, and hopefully get back to where it needs to be. Next, this is a little trick that you can do to apply the thermal paste once the board has cooled down. And also I should mention, don't touch the board, don't move it at all, let it cool down the room temperature. Don't try and move it because you might disturb the solder before it's done cooling. Cut off the part of the plastic bag, the tip of the plastic bag, and apply thermal paste to it. And then you can gently just kind of wipe this onto the top of the CPU and GPU. You don't need a lot, just probably about a pea size of it. And if you get a little bit on the rest of the chip, don't worry, it's not going to hurt anything. But try not to get too much on there. Just enough to like thinly coat the top of the surface so that we get a nice clean contact between the heatsink and the chip. Once you've done that, it's time to apply the heatsinks again. Definitely make sure those are clean. You're going to want to put the screw in through the back and then the nylon washer and then the metal washer on top of that. Make sure to get it that way. You don't want the metal washer on the bottom. So that screw through the board, nylon washer, then metal washer. And a little tip to get these things to stay in there is to use a little bit of scotch tape to holster them until you can get the heatsink in place and then start hand tightening them in. Once you got these hand tightened done, you can get your flathead screwdriver and in a X kind of pattern, start tightening them down. And don't worry about over tightening. Just get it pretty torqued down because you want to make sure that this heatsink has a really good tight contact. And then apply the next heatsink. Same thing. Make sure that it's facing the proper way. And then you can use the scotch tape kind of technique to make sure that they stay in there. And use an X pattern when tightening them down each a little bit at a time until they're all the way tightened. And then next in supplied in the kit is a couple of heat sinks that will go on a couple of chips that will help keep things cool. And then it's time to put the board back in the case. So while putting the board back in the case, make sure that you, you've cleaned all the dust out of it and take the opportunity to make sure all your components are dust-free and things like that. And then, yeah, just assemble the Xbox 360 in reverse order. And again, if you need pictures or detailed look, there's an iFixit walkthrough that's really detailed, and I'll have a link to that in the show notes. Now that I've got the Xbox back together, the moment of truth. Gonna see if this bad boy works again. Wait, what's that? I just finished fixing this Xbox, and the Xbox One is going to have backwards compatibility? Oh, well. Anyway, the list is really short right now for the Xbox One, so it's probably still worth it to try and fix your old Xbox 360. And now that it's fixed, it's time to play one of my favorite games.
I still enjoy playing my 360
games.
I
see you play Bioshock all the time on it.
I really enjoy Bioshock.
Yeah, well, you just like try to come up with the most complex way to kill big daddies. Yeah.
I do. Well, you know, that's the replayability. Because the first time you ever played Bioshock, the big daddies were terrifying.
Right.
I mean, oh my goodness.
And then
after a while,
it.
It's like, you know what? I'm going to pay you back for all those times you killed me. I'm going to attach 8 mines to this propane tank, and I'm going to put electric bolts next to it, and you're just going to blow up, and I see how far I can launch them. It's a thing.
Well, it was nice to be able to fix something for a friend. And if you're like me, and you have an Xbox 360 laying around, it can be a good thing to, like, gift to someone,
yeah.
Or put it in another room so that you don't get bothered when you want to play on the Xbox One.
Or how about this? If you have a busted 360, give it to a geek in your family along with an iFixit toolkit fixing kit for the Red Ring of Death. And it's something that makes them learn before they play.
It's a fun project.
How about that? Yeah, and they're not even a sponsor for this episode. Nope. But you know who is a sponsor for this episode?
No, I don't.
The source of all knowledge on the internet.
That would be Linda.
Linda.com. We talk a lot about the knowledge hole. Yeah. That's that thing that you got that you need to put stuff
in. Like in this area.
Yeah. It craves knowledge. It craves information. It craves really well-crafted courses. Now, I don't want to make fun of other entities on the internet who do great YouTube videos.
We are one of those entities.
We are one of those entities. but sometimes you want to cut past bad production values or bad lighting or bad audio. Or sometimes you just want to get exactly to what you need.
Yes.
Which is what Lynda.com is good for. Now, Lynda.com is for the people who are searching, for the people who want to learn, for the people who are curious about how the world works. It's for problem solvers. Now, maybe you want to develop an app. Maybe you want to master Excel. Maybe you want to take better photos or sharpen your Photoshop skills. Lynda.com has everything you need to feed your knowledge hole. Lynda.com just added some great new business courses, including Advanced Microsoft Project, FileMaker Pro 14, Essential Training, the Foundations of Business Analytics, and Operations Management Fundamentals. There's even a course on asking for a raise. Now, Lynda.com has been absolutely instrumental for the Brickhouse, not just for know-how, but for our editors. As we've switched over to Adobe Premiere, sometimes they just need to find out that one tool that existed in Final Cut that they need to know how to use in Premiere. Well, that's where the transcripts come into play. Rather than having to watch an entire module on Premiere, they could say, how do I get rate stretching? and it will look through the transcripts of their courses, find you exactly where you need to go. You play that piece of the video, boom, you got the answer, you can move on. Lynda's not just a place to learn, it's a place to reference your knowledge. You can watch and learn from top experts who are passionate about teaching. You can stream thousands of video courses on demand. You can learn on your own schedule. You can make playlists, share them with their friends, and you can download episodes to your iOS or your Android device so you'll always have them ready to go. I use lynda.com on my Android tablet so that if I've got some downtime, like, you know, if I'm on public transit, why not learn a little bit instead of just wasting the time? Your lynda.com membership gives you unlimited access to training on hundreds of topics, all for one low flat rate. Whether you're looking to become an expert, you're passionate about a hobby, or you just want to learn something new, I want you to visit lynda.com/knowhow. That's lynda.com/knowhow and sign up for your free 10-day trial. Again, that's lynda.com/knowhow. And we thank Lynda for their support of Knowhow.
I mean, there's only so much knowledge we can do in an hour. We would do more than an hour, but our director usually tells
Task
us to stop. So
master. He starts showing us the clock whenever he thinks we're wasting time, yep. Which is horrible.
When he thinks that we're just talking back and forth, yeah, and not really getting to the next segment.
Yeah, but
I'm surprised he hasn't stopped us by now.
I'm just getting it pulled up right now.
There we go. Oh, there we go. I don't think I could vamp any longer.
Curse you, director.
Sure. Well, folks, let's go ahead and take a step back to Maker Faire. We were both there. We both really, really enjoyed it. We're looking forward to
doing it next
year.
That was my first Maker Faire, and it was amazing. Yeah.
Yeah, it really was. One of the things that we saw was a way to generate power that is actually very old.
You're not talking about the kids on the bicycles,
no,
right?
No, okay, that's also very old.
That was
no,
the bicycle
is,
power,
this
yeah
is slightly different. This is called gasification. Now, yeah, if you want to know what gasification is, Ryan and I could tell you all about it, or our director could just push the button. I know here at TWiT we have talked a lot about alternative energy, but there is one that we haven't really talked about, and that is the use of gasification. I'm here with Richard, who's going to explain what gasification is. Now, Richard, people who have been dabbling with this for a while have just been extolling its praises. It's a great way to get energy out of things that we wouldn't normally get energy from. What is gasification?
Absolutely. It is it's an old technology. Basically, we're superheating a hydrocarbon and we're processing the smoke into a clean gas, a combustible gas that will run a standard engine with a generator connected to it. So today we are running a 20 kilowatt generator on walnut shells.
This is one of these technologies that has been around for a very, very long time, but it fell out of favor because, well, gasification has always been very inconvenient. You need a lot of material that can provide hydrocarbons. You need heat to be able to heat those hydrocarbons out of the material, and then you need some way to filter it into an engine. What have you done here to turn it into an all-in-one solution?
This is an integrated machine that processes the hydrocarbon through the gasification process, the filtering it, cleaning it, and providing a clean fuel source for the internal combustion engine. This is marketing for places where they're paying an extortive amount of money for diesel. We're replacing diesel generators in the deep developing worlds of where they have a lot of biomass that's available and no diesel.
Well, you know, that's just too bad that, yeah, we are kind of spoiled. We like our really cheap oil. We like our really cheap energy. And we take technologies like this and we just turn away from it. Now, if they wanted to find out more about gasification, about what you do for developing countries, where can they go?
Allpowerlabs.com.
of Father Robert Ballester, and the future might be gas.
From walnut shells.
From walnut shells.
I actually played around with this.
With walnut shells?
When I was not walnut shells, but when I was living in San Jose, I tried to make a gasifier to feed a generator.
It's not as easy as it sounds.
It really isn't. It really, it's dangerous. It's so dangerous.
It's so dangerous.
Okay, so what I had.
So listed under projects of may kill everyone.
May kill everyone. So I had two oil barrels. So there was an oil barrel, and then there was an oil barrel slightly smaller that fit into the oil barrel. So in the big oil barrel, you put all the wood that you were going to burn. In the small oil barrel, you put a lot of wood, and then you sealed it, and you had like a hose coming off of it. So the fire would heat up that small barrel, all of the hydrocarbons would leach out of the wood, and then you could draw that into the engine, which sounds really simple until you realize that you've just made a bomb. It's a pressure bomb.
Oh, yeah,
filled with explosive hydrocarbons in a
sitting
fire.
Sitting on top of a fire. Yeah, okay. I could see where you might have gone wrong with that.
Yeah, so... It worked.
Right up until the explosion.
No, until my superior came out and goes, "What are you doing?"
No.
And yeah, we had to stop.
Okay.
but, you know, given enough time, I would have made it safe.
No, probably not, right?
Yeah. It's a great option, though. If you live in a part of the world that doesn't have ready access to alternative energy or to petrol, and you have a lot of biomatter.
We take it for granted a lot of the time here that we could just go pick up diesel and stuff like that here.
Exactly.
But even at Maker Faire, we asked them sort of like, can we get one of these around here to look at? He's like, no, nobody would want to use this here.
Like, that was the weirdest thing. I'm like, why are you here? I mean, it seemed like he was saying, no, you don't want this.
You wouldn't like this.
This would be horrible.
He was trying to give us the hard sell.
He was
trying to play it off like, no. Gasification, no, it's not cool. Oh. You want to buy it, though?
But if Lisa and Leo will let me, I would like to build one for know-how.
Do we have a couple of oil cans laying around and stuff?
I'm sure Burke's got some. That would be awesome. And then they died. All right, folks, this is the part of the show where we normally do a parting shot. And a parting shot could be something from the chat room. It could be something from our Google Plus group. It could be just a story that we found. Mm-hmm. But instead, I wanted to give you a tool that I found that I think is incredibly cool. Hey, Brian.
What's that?
Have you ever wanted to visualize what the RF energy was like around you?
like the Matrix, kind of?
Like that.
See how the world around me.
This is how everything is connected.
Right.
Well, luckily, there's actually a way to do it. Now, there was a group called Cavill, Mertz, and Associates. I believe they deal with a lot of like building towers and such.
Uh-huh.
But they combined a database that they got from the FCC. It's a publicly available database of the transmitters that are operating in the United States, and they overlaid it onto a map for Google Earth.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Hey, Alex, go ahead and show them this. So this is Google Earth right now. I can go ahead and zoom in. Let's see. What do we want? Let's go.
Can we find Petaluma on this?
Petaluma. Where are you? Wait, where are we? Where is Petaluma?
A little down. There's the
bay area. There it is. Okay, so let's zoom in a tiny bit. Now, this, that's cool. It's Google Earth.
Yeah.
But now I've got this layer here that I can turn on. Let me see all the AM stations. Oh, okay, there's my AM stations. Let me see all the FM stations. How about TV stations?
Oh, that's a lot.
How about channel broadcast?
Oh.
How about ASR towers? How about broadcast microwave towers?
Whoa.
And I start to see all of the different transmitters and receivers that are operating in my area. Oh, this is just for the Bay Area, and look at that. I mean, this is nuts.
You can definitely see them clustered on the high points.
Actually, what's this one going out here? What's that?
What?
Oh, this is for the... what's the name of that island? There's an island off the coast it's a research center. Yeah, it's a natural preserve. Now, if I were to zoom out here, you can see they've got this all over the country. So you can travel through the United States, and you can find out exactly what kind of towers and what kind of data is being transmitted over your head.
You have a way of seeing that?
Yeah, so like, let's see, I want to find out what's here, so I zoom in. And it will tell me, okay, I've got an AM/FM tower, I've got a microwave tower. It'll show me these links. So those links are actually microwave links that are going back and forth, or RF links transmitting data between stations. So if you've ever wanted to find out how information makes it across the country, this is free. Just go ahead and download it. There'll be a link in the show notes and find out. Oh, gosh, look at this cluster right in the middle. What's that? This got the crazy dents.
Jeez.
Holy moly.
That must be Bob Howe's house.
That red dot, that's Bob. Wow.
There's a lot of the Ham Nation crew right there.
That's crazy. So again, useless information for most of us, but it's pretty cool. It's a nice way to visualize what's going on just over your head.
Okay. Can I say what I really thought you were going to show me, though?
What?
Was that I was going to wear these goggles and I could see RF signals in front of me. There's a really terrible movie, when just a little rant. It's called Lucy. It's
good. Yes.
And she like,
she's picking cell phone signals.
Yeah, signals out of the air.
That's how it works. Cell phone signals are all vertical in front of you,
Brian. I thought you were going to show me that. Yeah, you can see the beams of the cell phone coming straight up into the air.
Wow.
It's all right. We'll save it for a future project.
Yeah, yeah. one little thing that we want to do before we go away.
What's that?
Well, I don't know. Maybe something with this.
Okay, so the goggles are going to come into play.
They are going to come into play, but not for Lucy.
That's all right. That was 2 hours I'd never get back.
We know that you have been wanting to do FPV magic for quite a while. It's something that we really enjoy because it allows us to control our quadcopters. In fact, I had an incident this afternoon because I didn't have my goggles on.
An unnamed Twit employee may have been hit by a quad propeller.
Yeah, it happens. it's hazard of working here. It's cool. It's cool. But you know, these are kind of gank. These are not super, super high quality, but they're surprisingly useful. They're surprisingly good, and it's a great way to get in for just $100.
$100, yeah, that's a good entry point. And, you know, as long as it functions properly, I'm going to look nerdy with something strapped to my face like that anyway.
You're going to look nerdy, period.
Right. It doesn't take much, right? Yeah, we're starting with this.
Well, I could talk about it, or we could ask our director to push the magic button.
The Quantum FPV is an all-inclusive first-person view bundle for under $100. Out of the box, the kit contains a 200-milliwatt transmitter, receiver, Sony CCD camera, 4.3-inch LCD screen, lenses, housing, strap, and all the cables to connect your FPV system. The Quantum is a DIY and low-cost setup, so it may look a little jank, but it's a great way to get up and running with FPV on a budget. Assembling the kit starts by binding together the two halves of the housing to encase the LCD screen. I recommend Gorilla Glue, but you can use any adhesive that you want. Just remember that you want something that will bond strongly after drying and not rot over time. While you're bonding, make sure to install the foam strips into the housing's indentations. These strips will put force on the lens holder so that you can adjust it as needed. The next step is to mount your preferred lens into the holder. Don't use glue, because you may want to swap out the lens. Instead, just use small strips of clear tape to hold the edges to the frame. Using a dab of glue, attach the cross pieces to the lens frame. These will be the parts that are held by the foam strips in the housing. Set aside the housing pieces so that the glue can set, then open up the radio box and take out the transmitter, camera, wiring harness, and one of the circular antennas. On the back of the transmitter, you'll find a single connector for power and signal, as well as a dip switch block for setting channels and bands. This is what will allow you to run multiple FPV systems simultaneously. Connect the antenna to the transmitter. Important note, always connect an antenna to your transmitter before you power it on. If you don't have it connected, you can damage your transmitter. Take a look at the wiring harness. On one side, you'll see a JST connector. This is the power side. Now connect the transmitter and camera to the other side of the wiring harness and connect a 12-volt power source to the power side. You should see the power light on the transmitter. Power it down and set it aside. Now let's assemble the receiver. You'll need the receiver itself, the other circular antenna, the RCA to 3mm cable, the Y power cable, and the LCD screen. Connect the antenna to the receiver, then connect the power and 3.5mm cable to the ports on the bottom of the receiver. Connect the RCA ports from the signal cable to the RCA connectors from the LCD screen. Apply a 12-volt power supply to the Y connector, and the screen and receiver should turn on. Reconnect power to the transmitter assembly, and assuming that you haven't changed any of the default channel and band settings, you should see the image from the camera show up on your LCD screen. Let the system run for half an hour to make sure that everything will continue to work.
You may want to practice changing transmitter and receiver settings so that you can change them at will in the field. Along with the kit comes another cabling harness that has a USB connector on one end. This is an interface cable between the FPV transmitter and a GoPro camera. Connect the non-power end of the harness to the transmitter, then connect the USB connector to your GoPro and power it up. You'll see standard definition video out of your GoPro, usually with a better picture quality than the Sony CCD camera. Now that we know that the system is working, let's put the screen into our housing. Insert the LCD screen into the housing so that it fits into the notch of each half piece, with the bottom of the screen on the half that has the nose cutout. Insert the lens assembly, then bond the top half. I like a little extra adhesion, so I used black gaffer's tape to strengthen the bond and cover my sloppy glue work. If you assembled it properly, you should now be able to move the lens within the housing to focus the image to your liking. Take a blade and cut two slits to the pre-marked indents. This is where the head strap will go. Then attach the longer strips of foam tape to the top and bottom of the housing where it meets your face. Take your time and test fit it against your face to make sure that there are no rough patches or pressure points. Using a flat edge, push each end of the strap into the slits that you cut into the housing, then secure the edges within the housing. There you have it, an FPV headset that only a true geek could love.
Brian, I can see everything!
And you look really cool,
look
too.
And I look really good.
It's good that you can't see yourself when you wear those.
Look, I have to say this. I thought it was total jank, but I was watching one of my favorite channels on YouTube the
other
day.
Is it Flight Test?
It was the Flight Test guys, but it was also some of the people that they work with. And they were doing some incredible FPV videos.
Yeah.
And in one of the quadcopter shots, it swings by them, and they're all using these.
If they work, who cares what they look like?
Exactly. Now, you can get like the Father Sky or the Fat Shark glasses, and those are great, or the immersion, and those are fantastic. But, you know, if you're just starting off and you don't want to spend $500, $600, $800, $1,200, $100 FPV kit is not bad at all.
Well, let me ask you this, Padre. Are you getting into quadcopters to be cool? Yeah. Or are you getting into quadcopters to have fun?
You know, we've both given up on looking. You're not going to look cool. No. You may look cool in your head, but no, it's not.
Same with Segways. Totally gave up on it.
Yeah.
And I think the application for this ranges beyond quadcopters.
It's way beyond quadcopters.
I know our director, Al Grumpel. He wants us to use them for hats. We'll put them on hats,
Brian,
during the show. What's that?
That's Grumpel.
Gumpel. Yeah, I'm going to get it right one of these days.
Yeah, no, probably.
But we'll wear hats and we'll walk around the set with them on, and that's what we'll use.
We've got people in the chat room asking if they could use a phone or if they could use like a virtual reality headset. You could. There's latency in the phone, and you don't want latency.
Yeah, especially when it comes to FPV.
Yeah, and as for the virtual reality headsets, I'm sure eventually that will become useful when you have multiple cameras on a quadcopter and you can make like an immersive view. The problem with FPV's headsets, I mean with like virtual reality headsets, is you would actually need to transmit a lot of data back from your quad that's moving very quickly. Yeah. This is all standard def, and even then it breaks up quite a bit. So, actually another thing, I tried a digital transmitter.
Yeah.
Don't do that. That's horrible. It's horrible because digital, it doesn't get fuzzy, it just stops. Just breaks up, so you just lose video.
That would be scary.
Yeah, this you can kind of still see a little bit of what's going on,
even if it gets a little interrupted.
Right. So yeah, not bad.
Okay.
Cool. And they all are digital in transmission, but stick with an analog system like this.
I want to play with these now.
I gave you one, and you're gonna build it. And
so
I'm
I should
build
watch
this.
That video again to build
watch
it.
Watch the video to build it. Put it together, and we'll do some FPV racing. In fact.
Sweet.
Our friends from LowPro, they came by because they're a local company.
Mm-hmm.
They want to partner with us on starting up an FPV league.
Ooh, a little competition, huh?
Yeah, so there's three of us. There's you, myself, and Tony, who can fly quadcopters right now. We'll be flying from FPV.
Okay.
And we're trying to get a couple of guys from around the Bay Area, maybe get a starting 12.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do
some racing.
Yes.
I'm up for that.
Indeed. Now, folks, or we could just do that. Yes.
There's some racing for you.
Cool.
Looking so cool.
Oh my goodness! Yeah, let's burn that. Let's just delete that. That's not good. Folks, we know that this was a lot of information, and thank you very much for watching. Mm-hmm. We want to give you an easy way to do any of the projects that we just played with, including the FPV goggles, including looking at the Gassifier link, and including Brian's Red Ring of Death fix. Ryan, if only there was a place they could go on the internet to find those notes.
Yeah, like a repository of knowledge at Linda. Not Linda. No, twit.tv/KH. That's the one.
Yeah.
All our past episodes live there, so you can thumb through the links to all the stories that we bring up, or if it's an episode like this where you want to buy stuff for a project, go through that, and you'll be able to find what you need. Although I feel like for some of the projects we've done, you kind of have to get on it quick because they sold out with a lot of the quad parts that we've offered.
Yeah. So, if you're watching this 3 weeks later, maybe they've restocked by now, so just go get them. Also, don't forget that we've got a Google Plus group. It's a very strong Google Plus group. Just go to Google Plus, look for know-how, jump in, join the conversation. It's active, filled with experts, intermediate folk, and newbies. It's just a place that you can go and try out your ideas. If you have a project that you want help with, if you want to help other people with projects, and definitely if you want to get your questions or your projects on the show, that's the place to go.
Yeah, I love going on there. It's a great place to engage, and then we get videos like from, was it 610
Bob? 610
Bob. From last episode. Yeah, that was amazing. And then that gives us more ideas, and we get an idea of what people want to see and stuff, so.
Yeah. Of course, that's not the only place that you can find us. We exist in the tweeters, don't we?
We do. We in the cloud of tweeters.
Tweeters.
We are on Twitter at @I'm_cranky_hippo.
I'm at @PadreSJ, and there's another guy.
The director,
Al Grump?
Hal.
I think it's Hal. Hal Grumple. You can find him at Anelf. That's ANELF3.
He's making us suffer.
He really is. This got all the power here. This is not good. Follow him. He's our director, and he sits there. He makes sure that we stay on time.
Yes, he does.
Never. That's not gonna happen.
Oh man.
Okay. We gotta close this up before he does something else. Oh wait.
People don't know.
He's playing with time.
He has that power. Too much power, in fact.
Just finding the perfect frame.
Right. That's right where I thought I was gonna fall off the segue.
But you looked so
cool. Is that why you wobble?
That is exactly why I wobble.
But no. But that was a cool wobble.
Yeah.
It's a cool wobble. Know what?
That's my life in a nutshell.
It's about to fall off, and you just look
about
cool.
It's on the edge of destruction, and just try and pull it off right before I fall flat on my face.
No, my life is I just fall.
Well, that's why you got the GoPro on your head. You got the FPV stuff. You'll be all right.
Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballasaire.
And I'm Brian Burnett.
And now that you know how.
Go crash.
Or don't crash.
I forget how we ended. Go break stuff.
Yeah.